So let's start with some conceptual information, really terminology and concepts that will help you to better understand the following parts of this module. You can skip ahead if you're already familiar with MinIO or you're coming from an object storage background, but it would be good to just walk through this as a refresher. So a term we're going to use a lot in this module is object. And what is an object? Object typically refers to the binary large object or blob. And don't let large throw you off. It really is just the contents of your local computer. These are the regular files and media resources that you interact with on a daily basis. They can have any size, format, structure, or type. And they don't depend on a specific hierarchy for access or availability. One important thing that distinguishes the blob from other types of data structures is that blobs have rich metadata, which often provides additional context around that object, maybe what it is or how it was created. Now, you already interact with objects as part of your personal and professional computer use. These are photos, music, videos, and documents. They're the raw or intermediate data from AI or machine learning pipelines. It could be streaming and time series data coming out of a metrics generator, IoT devices, or sensors. And it could be archival backups from applications or dedicated backup software. What groups all of these together is that they have every one of the attributes of a blob. There's no limitation on size, format, structure, type, or hierarchy, and all of these have associated metadata that is exceedingly important when it comes to identifying what that particular object is and the context around it. The other term we're going to use a lot is bucket, and if you're coming from the AWS S3 world, you might already be familiar with this. But if you're not, a bucket is effectively a collection of related objects, policies, and configurations. When applications write or read objects, they're always doing it from a bucket, and the policies and configurations associated to that bucket are what control access and behavior. You can think of a bucket a little bit like a volume in a file system context, something like an NFS mount or a database or an export. From the S3 world, there's a limit of around 100 buckets per account, and then each bucket has a global unique DNS name or host name. MinIO doesn't have those kind of bucket limits because we're deploying onto whatever infrastructure you want, so there's no constraint around DNS names per bucket, or the number of buckets that MinIO can host on any given deployment. That said, it's still a good idea to think of a bucket like a volume, in the sense that if you have hundreds or even thousands of buckets, in the same way that having hundreds or even thousands of volume mounts, it might indicate that you need to take a closer look at how you're storing your data and consider it more efficient uses. Now, applications typically don't create volumes. They consume them. What that means is that object storage administrators will create the bucket for apps to use. This includes configuring the buckets and setting up access policies to allow access to those buckets. And you can do this using the graphical console, the MinIO CLI, or the MinIO S3 API. Now, there is an API in case you need to do programmatic bucket creation for workloads that require it, such as something like storage as a service. But generally speaking, applications interact with buckets to put and get, which is the equivalent of writing and reading objects, with no real constraint on the hierarchy of storage or access. The applications themselves actually kind of define the overall hierarchy of objects as they write and read objects in and out. So what is object storage? Well, it's easiest to talk about object storage in terms of the attributes that you can associate to it. With object storage, there has to be support for flexible namespaces, or buckets, which store data in any arbitrary hierarchy, whether it's very flat, meaning no subfolders, or too deeply nested, so many subfolders. The objects stored in object storage have to consist of a unique ID, the actual object data, and the full metadata, and there should be no reliance on an external application or middleware for being able to tie all of these things together. There should be unlimited scaling of the storage resource through technologies like storage pools, meaning that you can go from a few terabytes of object storage to exabytes of object storage. You should have access to an HTTP-based RESTful API, and this allows for platform-agnostic access, where you don't have to use proprietary libraries or wire protocols to perform basic input-output. object storage should be cloud native. That by design allows your deployment to any infrastructure, whether it's bare metal or orchestrated management methods. Now we are going to be talking about this concept of S3 compatibility during this module. And what we mean here is we're talking about the AWS Simple Storage Service. Now S3 is itself a RESTful object storage service. It is one API that any S3 compatible service can attempt to implement. And the nice thing about this is it gives you some portability of applications. If you have an application that relies on the S3 API, you can generally use that to move your application across object storage resources. And this also gives inherent support for multi-cloud deployments, assuming that your object storage resource implements the S3 API and is capable of deployment to multiple cloud environments. Now, not all object storage services are S3 compatible. They may also only provide partial compatibility at most. Furthermore, S3 is not open source. The API itself is public, but the implementation details and underlying behavior require testing and reverse engineering to ensure actual compatibility. So, given this extra burden, why is S3 compatibility important? S3 is a common integration point. Software providers are increasingly including S3 compatibility as part of their service offerings. And this allows deploying S3 compatible object storage as a central resource for an entire ecosystem of applications. And this includes applications like Spark, which traditionally relied on something like the Hadoop Distributed File System, or HDFS, for the massive scale high performance storage. The latest versions of Hadoop actually include a robust and performant S3 connector for direct read and write access to S3 compliant storage. What this means in summary is that if you have object storage that isn't S3 compatible across the entire S3 API, you are necessarily going to be limited in your ability to maximize your usage of many of these new software environments. There's one last thing we need to talk about, and that is erasure coding. Erasure coding is a data redundancy and availability feature that allows MinIO deployments to automatically reconstruct objects on the fly, even if you've lost multiple drives or nodes in the cluster. This is an object level healing process with less overhead than adjacent technologies such as RAID or replication. With erasure coding, MinIO shards each object into data and parity blocks, distributing them across multiple drives in the deployment, such that the loss of any one drive has no effect on the ability to retrieve and reconstruct that object. Now, erasure code parity itself is tunable, so you can choose lower parity values to maximize your available storage, and higher parity values to maximize resiliency to node or drive loss. It's always going to be a trade-off because parity by its nature requires some amount of storage space. Now, knowledge of erasure coding is not necessary to complete this module. It's helpful to have the term in your mind because it's going to come up as we talk about some of the deployment topologies. That said, it's sufficient to know that it is something that allows us to have high availability and resiliency without depending on RAID or similar technologies.